service level in some places.
Okay, thank you. Before we start, today was the funeral of Olivia Pratt-Korbel, and I wondered whether we could stand for a bit of silence. I'm sure it would be also for people who passed away last week.
Chair. I just really wanted some clarification as per the terms of reference. Given the wording in the terms of reference and the recent report from the commissioners and the appointing of a new commissioner to lead on finance, I don't understand how the assurances, how you're going to hold accountability. I don't understand the juxtaposition between that role and that person's role and what we do here. And I've asked a similar question at finance and resources. How do we hold financial decisions taken by a centrally appointed commissioner to account at this point? I just simply don't understand how we do some of the things that are written in this terms of reference. And if we are unable to do some of the things, and I could go through line by line, there's lots that we're actually unable to actually deliver. What are our revised terms of reference?
Say
challenge that ruling or it doesn't quite have that status is if we think that decision of the Information Commissioner is wrong in the context of information law, we have 28 days to challenge that decision, just as anybody does in respect to the decision, and if not 35 days, so another 5 days, another 7 days, to comply with that ruling. The current position is we are having looked at the decision, we're in the position where we're unlikely to challenge that and therefore we're likely to comply with their view that it should be disclosed, but it is subject to a number of redactions, particularly with regard
thanks a lot. I'd just like to sort of pay tribute a little bit to the Mayor of Liverpool. We've had our differences over the last couple of months, but I take my hat off to her for having the courage to bring this to light now. And I'm sure that moving forward into this BICO report, that we can get some justice for it and we can start to shed some light. But my questions come from the finance side of it, sorry. And basically, I asked the question in the last audit committee regarding the three wards that were assured in the BICO report that the money would go back.
That's finance resources
committee, wasn't it? So, yeah, the joint, yeah. So, I asked that question regarding where that money is, and can that money be then put back into the wards that it recommended in this Labour Party report? I think it was something like 84,000 quid was lingering around to go into the wards. So I have a number of questions, Chair. And the first question is how much funding has been recovered from BICO? Can I just move on to the last couple of questions then? Okay, so what I'll do is my questions that I've raised regarding the finance, I'll write them into the Chair of Finance for answers. And
okay.
So just leading on to the last couple of questions is I'd like to ask the committee that when did this ongoing investigation that Mike Jones stated in the audit committee to me, the last audit committee, when did it begin? When he said there was an ongoing investigation into this as we speak, so I'd like to know the dates of when it started.
Again, I believe the questions that you were asking again refer to the finance resources, so I don't know the direct conversation that you had, but really, yeah, those
questions. If it's this, I mean, if the council have come forward with questions, then I'll seek to get an answer to you.
Is it worth
a little bit of confusion?
Is it worth asking me the last question, Chair? Can I ask the last question if it's worth anything? I mean, we've got to bear in mind that this has been going on now. This carbuncle, this cyst, right, has been going on since round about 2013, 2014. This report that came out, that's been circulated to the whole world in itself, has been going around since 2018. Now, we've had councillors who I respect, who resigned from the Labour Party because of this particular incident back in 2018 and 19. So, it's not a question, it's the fact that this is a journey. The members of the public were putting in complaint after complaint after complaint since 2018, 2019, and it was kicked into the long grass. Now, my last point is, in the memorandum of articles in BICO, it states this, I'll state what it says, it states the golden vote. So whoever set up the memorandum of articles within BICO had this veto in the golden vote, it was called. So the question I'd like to ask here is, what is the golden vote? And who had the responsibility of triggering it?
Unless any individual officers can comment and come back on this stuff, which I'm not free enough to do, may I suggest that for your particular questions that we will get you a written response in relation to those. Some of those questions will be for finance and resources.
Thanks, Chair. Yeah. Appreciate that.
Councillor Kemp.
Thank you, Chair. And like previous questioners, I too would like to congratulate the elected mayor on the very frank and open statement she made yesterday, which I thought was very refreshing. And I'd like to associate that with being nice to the monitoring officer. This doesn't happen too often. But in his email response to me, he said the default position for reports such as this stands would be to publish. And many of us know that hasn't always been the default position in the council. So I'm quite reassured that we've got political, the managerial leadership on these issues in accord and moving for transparency. But there are two questions that I've got. The first of these, Rebecca mentioned some of the ways that these reports can go, is where else has this report gone, the unredacted one that we're talking about? Because I would have been very happy for you to turn around today and say, for example, that we can't remove it yet because the police are looking at it, or the, I was going to say Her Majesty's Tax Office, His Majesty's Customs and Excise were looking at it. So do we know if this report has gone to the police and tax authorities as part of their ongoing investigations, because that's the drift of the allegations. And the second one was that when the report was first produced, and I've been at it since it was, so that's 4.5 years ago, I was offered the opportunity to go and see the report, provided I signed a non-disclosure agreement, read it in front of an officer, and didn't copy anything. Now, as we're going to have a redacted now and a non-redacted report, is that offer to see the non-redacted report, the original as it were, still available to me and or other councillors on the same terms that it was offered originally? Because that might then help us make more sense of what gets published.
Obviously, because of the limited knowledge of your interactions in the past, there's only so much I can say to that. What I would say is obviously members have additional access rights to council information in addition to the general public's rights which are under Freedom of Information Act, and I'm quite happy to look at those and review those when we have the redactions and liaise with you and or any other member in respect to that. With regards to the police, I suppose for reasons that are obvious, I can't really answer that question. Does that make sense?
Well, I think you not being able to answer it is actually answer the question. I'm happy for you to leave it there on
my list. It might well be a double bluff, you never know.
Thank you, Chair. I'm Councillor Cummings, Councillor for Waverley Ward, the only resident Waverley Ward Councillor for Waverley. Two issues I have with regard to the BECO situation. One, transparency. That's what I want to deal with first. So following this with the BECO discussion that's been mentioned, one of my ward residents, who's actually here at the moment, Ms. Stolzberg, had communication with Liverpool City Council about on an FOI, and she wanted confirmation that North West Housing had communication with Liverpool City Council. In the report, it proves that North West Housing are the bootkeepers of BECO, and they are in fact in the official registered office of North West Housing.
I'm what has got to do with the report itself, and it.
Right, so the question is, can you please explain why Liverpool City Council's denial of links with North West Housing is going on?
To be frank, I'm afraid that's got nothing to do with matters being discussed.
Yeah, I'm in agreement.
I want to come back on that, Chair. Please explain to me why it's got nothing to do with my question, and I'm asking that the residents of Waverley Ward wanted confirmation that Liverpool City Council have links with North West Housing. Liverpool City Council said simple, so I'd like a response.
I don't think that was responsive to this particular item.
I would like a response to that, please.
Well, okay, my response is in relation to that, how I don't see the relevance of this. I also don't understand how anyone here could be able to answer that at this committee. However,
Chair,
if you have a question in relation to that...
Chair, you did not respond. Your colleague there responded, and I responded to him.
I do not believe that this is relevant to this particular item. However, I'm happy to look into the item for you, should you wish to email myself and perhaps Democratic Services as well, and we will make sure that a response is given to that. So if you have a response from our officer in relation to that particular question, but I don't see how this particular question is relevant to the item. Okay, any other questions? Okay, let's move on from that then. Item D then, relating to the update on Mazars energy report. This is in relation to a series of questions that I had in relation to the last report that we were given on the joint meeting on finance, resources, and law.
lost track of it.